From the beautiful College Football Hall of Fame in Atlanta, Georgia, this is Campus Lore Live presented by Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. I'm your host, Drew Butler, joined as always by my co-host, Aaron Murray. Special guest this week, Atlanta Falcons star defensive tackle and Clemson Tiger alumni, Grady Jarrett. Grady, thanks so much for being here at this awesome place with us this week. Want to talk to you about one thing right off the bat. Growing up with NFL influence, right? Mm-hmm. I had the same thing. My dad played in the NFL for 13 years. He's getting inducted to the Chicago Sports Hall of Fame next week. Shout out to Kevin Butler. Talk about how that has shaped your perspective, not only in college when you played at Clemson, but now being in the NFL and the privilege that it is.
Yeah, man, having different NFL influences, you know, whether it's from Ray Lewis, Jesse Tuggle, Ed Reed, just guys who really poured into me as a young child. I kind of knew what it take to try to be great at a position. All these guys I speak about, they were great at what they do. So it was, I mean, for me, seeing that firsthand, there was not much anybody from the outside could tell me on what it take to be great. So, I mean, I was definitely blessed to be put in a position to be around guys who had such success in the NFL, something that I always wanted to do. I was the guy who they told never was going to be able to do that. You know, they said I was too short. You know, I wasn't a highly recruited guy. Got a chance to go to Clemson, made the most out of that. And here I am today going to my fourth year, in my fourth year now with the NFL. And, you know, don't plan on slowing down no time soon. So I feel like the best is still ahead of me. But having those influences as a young child definitely shaped who I am as far as a man and a player today.
No doubt. Certainly making your mark felt with the Atlanta Falcons. You are a big-time player on that defensive line. Having those influences, and you said, great success from those guys. I mean, Ray Lewis in the Hall of Fame, Ed Reed up to be a Hall of Famer this year on his first chance to get on the ballot. Is it more so a technique thing, or is the mental preparation now for you?
I think more than anything, the mental aspect separates good from great, okay to whatever, because, you know, when you get to the NFL, even on the college level, everybody there can play. Mm-hmm. I feel like the mentality is what that little thing that separates even the guys who work hard. Everybody gonna work hard, but you know, you gotta put in that extra work, and I take that mentality to put in the extra work to get to where you wanna be is what's gonna separate you. And so knowing that doing the bare minimum, just what your strength coach wants you to do, that's not gonna be enough. Just what your coach tell you to do, that's not gonna be enough if you wanna be great. Yeah. If you wanna get by, you do what you take to get by. But I feel like me learning those lessons early showed me that good just not good enough. And I'm definitely thankful learning that at an early age.
No question. I think one of the things, Aaron, that really my dad told me from a young age is you got to give it 100%, right? And then it's just from week to week preparation. How are you going to be able to perform your best on Saturday or Sunday? You clearly did that. Your college resume is one of the best ever. What were some of your influences that made you reach that success?
Well, I completely agree. It's the little things because, like you said, in middle school and high school, everyone's good, but you're elite. You're an elite player. That's why you get recruited. That's why you win championships. Then you get to college, and everyone's a little bit better. Then the pyramid gets a little bit more narrow, and then you get to the NFL, and everyone's good. I mean, everyone was a five-star recruit. Everyone went to a big college. These guys are getting paid to play football, getting paid to play football for a reason because they are the best in the world. What separates them? What separates Tom Brady from these other quarterbacks? It's the little things. It's the diet. It's the getting more sleep. It's the not going out at night. It's the extra film study. It's the details. And we talk about all the time, details, details, details. That's what separates you. When everyone's really good, it's those small little things that can take you to that next step, turn you to an all-pro, turn you to a Hall of Famer, and that's what makes these guys great.
Aaron, you were highly recruited coming out of college, going to Georgia. You just mentioned you might have been overlooked a little bit when you were recruited going to Clemson. I'm just a punter, so my recruitment was a little bit different than some other people's. But, you know, maybe that chip on your shoulder, and then you slip to the fifth round. I wouldn't say slip because now you've had so much success in the NFL. Do you carry that even to this day?
Oh, man, without a doubt. I feel like that's never going to leave me, you know. Like I said, coming out of high school, I wasn't highly recruited. I wasn't even really recruited by my own state schools, you know what I'm saying? UGA want to show me no love. Not to the very end. Georgia Tech really showed me love to the end, man. I was doing the camp circuit, you know? So, man, I went up to Clemson a couple times over my high school after, my sophomore year, sophomore, junior, then going into my senior year, we go up to Clemson, And my mom driving me, she like, look, this is our last time coming up here. You go out here, do what you need to do. If they don't want to do nothing, cool. So I went out there, killed it. Coach Sweeney pulled me in his office and offered me a scholarship right there. And, you know, we in there having a meeting, and he was like, yo, so what you think? You know, I don't have no more scholarships left. I already have a another short defensive tackle. He was talking about a guy named Deshaun Williams at the time. And I told him, like, I don't know, I'll think about it. Give me a week. My mama looked at me so crazy, like, like, boy, you better take this. So I ended up calling Coach Sweeney, like, the next day, committing to Clemson. And so I was where I wanted to be. And then as far as getting drafted, to me, which I felt like was falling to the fifth round. I mean, coming out, you know, I had early projections from late first all the way to third round at the worst situation. But ended up falling to the fifth. And but I ended up in a great situation here in Atlanta, in my hometown. I couldn't paint a better situation for myself personally. So I mean, I just took that and ran with it, made the most out of it, became the player that I knew I was going to be regardless of wherever I was picked. And so just using the things that I felt like were obstacles to me from the outside looking in as motivation to be better. And for me, it ain't even about proving people wrong. It's about proving the people that believed in me right. So I'm definitely, man, this is just the beginning, and that's just how I go.
No, I mean, you've certainly done that. Aaron, I don't know if you know this, but Grady had 3 sacks in Super Bowl 51. That's tied for a Super Bowl record. So keep doing your thing, man. That motivation and persistence is certainly proving the doubters wrong and the believers right, which is awesome. All right, let's get into what happened last week in college football. A lot went down, and some giants fell, Aaron. We're going to ask, what was the best road win last week? Because there was a big-time battle in the SEC. LSU traveled to Auburn. But then a school out west, BYU, the Cougars went into Madison, Wisconsin, and beat the number 5-ranked Wisconsin Badgers.
Yeah, the Big Ten East right now and the Big Ten West, Big Ten in general, has just been just bad.
Yeah,
I mean, I was high on them, but they have just disappointed, I think, everyone. High expectations for that league. But I got to go LSU at Auburn. Auburn, 2 years in a row, have had the game under control. They're feeling great. Offensively, they're moving the ball. Defensively, they're doing a great job. Then Greedy Williams, one of the best corners in the country. Big interceptions, get the momentum back for that team. And then Joe Burrow, Mr. 46% completion percentage, just does enough, to get that team the win. But they've won 2 big games. They beat Miami on the road. I know it's a neutral site, but on the road. And then being Auburn, a very good Auburn team on the road. Listen, they're deserving of top 10 right now. That's huge. But we talked about it. When you're playing great talent, and you know it, When you're playing elite teams in the big stage, you can't take the pressure off. We had the issue when we played Alabama. I remember Alec Ogletree blocks a field goal. We're up by 11 points. I'm like, I'm thinking of South Beach, man. I'm like, we're going to Miami. We're playing Notre Dame. We're going to the championship. And we relax. We relax in that fourth quarter. They come back and beat us. Same thing happened last year in the national championship game. Georgia's up. They put the backup in. Oh, we're going to win. We feel good. They put the backup in. This is definitely over. Tua leads them, and they win the game right there. You play elite teams, it's not over until it's over. There's no relaxing. And I feel like Auburn, they started to chill defensively. They started to chill offensively. And it came back and bit them in the butt, and they lost a big game at home. And it really hurts their chances of getting to the playoffs later in the season.
No doubt. I mean, being at Clemson, you know the significance of those big-time rivalries in conference. What do you think is the most important thing to do as a team to get those big-time road wins?
Man, you got to stick together. I think Aaron said it, man. You can never relax, no matter how early you get up. To me, watching football, is the teams that get up real early in the game, I kind of get worried for them because it's a long game. You still got another half to play. When you come out of the half, and you know, you guys know, when you come back out of the half, it's really a whole new mindset. Yeah. It's a whole new game. So I remember my senior year, we go down to Florida State, and we on them all game. And this my senior year, I know we want to get to the playoffs. It's the first year that the college playoffs, you know, but we know that's a big game for us, for our program. And we on Florida State, we on them, but we making mistakes. Snap the ball over the quarterback head, now we out of field goal range. I don't think we had like a wide open touchdown that just got thrown in the ground. Defense led over a couple scores. And then before I knew it, we up in overtime against their backup quarterback at the time because Jameis wasn't playing. And so a team that we felt like we should have had a good win resume on us, we lost to them in overtime. And that kind of reshaped our season because now we down early in the season against lost two big games to Georgia the first game.
That's right.
And then to Florida State, what up, was game three, game four. And now we kind of just, you know, fighting out a hole. So them big games, especially when you play a team that you don't get to play often, which I kind of, what I like about the way Coach Sweeney sets up the schedule, he sets up games, we play people that we don't usually play. Like, yeah, they just played A&M. And, but he always been like that. You know, I play Auburn on the schedule, UGA twice.
That's right.
So it's good to be able to play those games to build up your resume, to have your team ready for battle time, crunch time at the end of the year, you battle tested. So, I mean, you guys said it the best. You have to be ready in those big games to put your best foot forward. Man, and if you have a program, I think the best way to approach it is every game, I mean, you got to be ready.
Yeah.
You can mess around and get slipped up. Oh, we're going to go out here, raw, have beat this team, and they mess up your season for real. Yep,
no doubt.
So, I mean, I'm sure we had a couple games like that, so games you're not expected to lose, and some big-time schools lose.
For sure. I always felt like when you were going into a big-time road atmosphere, right, so like LSU traveling to Auburn, I felt like the team's focus was always a lot better. No real distractions, right? Your families are going to be there, but your schedule's so tight on the road, you don't really have a lot of time to hang out with them in the hotel lobby or go get dinner with them. It's not like a home game where you're going to be hanging out and everybody's coming to town, your girlfriend's there. All that stuff's kind of thrown to the wayside. You really have that opportunity to zoom focus, and clearly BYU and LSU both did that last week. When teams lose like that, it's never good, but when you start off 0-3 or 1-2 and you just got paid a boatload of money to coach that team, problems rise quickly. And especially in the social media age we're in now, it's like fire him, get a new coach, get on Twitter, Instagram, like ruin people's lives immediately after one loss. But you look at the college football landscape right now. Willie Taggart was paid a huge salary to go to Florida State. They just got smoked by Syracuse at Syracuse. Scott Frost, defending national champion from UCF, like you
national
like to
champ.
Say. 0-2, I believe, because they had their one game canceled.
They got a walk-on quarterback starting
okay.
right now.
We're
they
gonna
got a walk-on quarterback.
But then Chip Kelly, 0-3. Yeah. I mean, Chip Kelly took a year off from being the head coach of the Philadelphia Eagles. Now he's at UCLA, 0-3. How do you do? I mean, what do you do? Do you fire him? What's the answer, Aaron?
No, you can't fire him. First off, I'm going to defend Scott Frost here. He names a starting quarterback. The rest of his guys transfer. He's left with a walk-on as a backup. Starting quarterback goes down. Now you have a freshman walk-on as your starting quarterback with a Nebraska team that's still rebuilding under Scott Frost with a new system. So I give him the most room for having these mistakes early on. Willie Taggart, I think, is unacceptable at Florida State. I mean, you can't lose, and not just lose, but get smoked and not
by
put
Virginia
points
Tech
up on
and
offense.
And by Syracuse.
It's embarrassing. And I know Virginia Tech's a good team, good defense. And then Syracuse with their quarterback Dungy, good football team as well. But I want to talk about Chip Kelly, and you talk about social media and the world going on right now. His starting quarterback, Dorian Thompson Robinson, his father this week gets on the Twitter during the game, starts tweeting, "This offense is awful. I don't know what Chip Kelly's doing. My son's better than this." Just going on a rant, you know, pretty much like LeVar Ball out here, you know, the new UCLA dad.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, what are you doing, man? You can't put a coach like that on blast. And I feel bad for his son, actually, because you're a freshman quarterback.
Yeah, helping the kid out.
He's a freshman quarterback. The guy's scared to get in the huddle, and all of a sudden you're going to get in the huddle. I'm sure the defense this week is going to be heckling him. Like, hey, why don't you call your daddy?
Oh, they're going to be on him.
They're going to be on
him.
So not only Chip Kelly put on blast, but now the son, too.
Yeah, I mean,
I think it's a whole bad look
for the program. That doesn't help out anybody. And Grady, you know Florida State really well, having played against them a number of years in college. 1-2 is not acceptable, and their two losses, as Aaron mentioned, were blowouts. That offense looks terrible. What are the fans doing in Tallahassee?
I mean, I don't know. I know that's definitely something that they're not used to. I'll say this. When you get a new coach in a new system, new program, sometimes you got to give them time to get the culture in the program, how they're going. But when you get to these top schools like Florida State, you know, Nebraska, the people that got a lot of good players already there almost, is when the fans not used to losing like that.
No.
You know, and I talk mess with Devontae Freeman all the time about Florida State. So, I mean, this is a prime time for me to be able to talk mess to him.
Yes, capitalized.
it's definitely uncharted territories for those programs. I'm sure the fans want better.
It is uncharted territory. And I would just say this. I mean, give these guys some time, right?
They're
trying to create
some
culture.
Yeah.
They're trying to get their ways set throughout the entire administration from the top down, recruiting. I mean, there's so much that goes into it.
The year before I went to Clemson, Sweeney just had his first year. They was like 6-7 at Clemson. And it's like everybody was, you know, like, all right, is this the guy for us? But every year since I've been there, my freshman year, they won at least 10 games every year from so on and so forth. They got a national championship. You got to give them time to get their culture set.
Well, the issue is with Willie Taggart is the cupboard's not empty. I mean, there is a ton of talent at FSU.
Yeah, without a doubt.
And it's not just losing games. Sometimes it's the way they're losing them. I mean, they offensively, and Willie Taggart's supposed to be a great offensive mind. He's at USF. They're a top-running program. Goes to Oregon. They're kicking butt running the football. Goes to FSU with great talent. They got a great running back in Cam Akers. And they can't score points. It's not like you inherit a team that's bad. We have no great talent. Yeah. This is FSU we're talking about here. Lose, but at least make it competitive. And I think that's what the fan base is mad about. We're getting waxed on TV against Syracuse, against Virginia Tech.
Yep.
And that's why there's a GoFundMe page right now to get him fired.
I did not know that. That's crazy.
It's uncharted territory.
I wonder what
that's
up to now.
It's uncharted territory. Another thing that's
Drew put some money in.
Yeah, me? Yeah, of course. Something that hasn't been seen in Tallahassee for quite some time. Another thing that hasn't been seen for quite some time that happened last week. North Texas ran one of the best fake punt returns I've ever seen. Grady, we talked about it pre-show. You said you couldn't believe those guys fell for it. But what happened is North Texas punt returner ran up to the ball, and he was waving like it was a Peter call, like the ball was going to drop short. Okay. He got up underneath it, caught it, just stood there. Everybody runs around him. He waits about 3 seconds, darts up the left sideline, and house calls it. Now, I've seen some pretty impressive fake punts. That one was executed very well. That kid deserves an Oscar award for his acting.
That took a lot of courage.
It absolutely did.
He could have went and got smacked.
They could have. If somebody had their head on straight, they could have absolutely
feast or famine. I know.
That punt team that let that happen, I know they got ripped in that meeting that day after. Because, I mean, as you're going down approaching the returner, and we had this discussion in the locker room meet, and I'm like, he never waved fair catch.
Yeah, you got to go way over your head, like, too clear over the shoulders.
Just because, like, what makes you think that he not going to return his ball?
It's crazy.
I didn't see the fake Peter call at first. I didn't see that part. But I don't understand how did they just let him.
I'll blame referees. Referees are softening the game of college football and professional football. These guys are so scared to hit people. They don't want to do anything. They're afraid they're going to get targeted, get out of the game. It's awful, Aaron. They're ruining the game.
Okay.
They are.
He's like the coach for North Carolina over here.
They are.
Drew wants no helmets.
All right, but you talk about that fake punt. I mean, crazy things are happening. Last week, three teams paid $1 million or more for opponents to come to their home stadium, and they lost. I mean, what is going on in college football? Did you ever even come close to losing to a cupcake team?
No, never. Okay, first off, Vanderbilt's not cupcake. I know you're just prying me right now to get it out of me.
I don't know.
Vanderbilt at Vanderbilt. You know that that's a tough place to play.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
No, it's not.
Right. Okay. No, let me defend myself here. It is so quiet, and there's no fans. And
it's so like, quarterback's complaining about it being too quiet.
You gotta get the juice going. I walk into that stadium like, man, this looks like a high school stadium. Like, I would get more fans at my high school games than Vandy. It's 11 o'clock in the morning. There's no one there. I'm like, this is like, why are we here right now? Like, this is it's tough to get up for those.
That's
kind
tough because I mean, I look forward to going to road games. It's like real, like kind of almost hostile environment. Yeah. Get your juice going when ain't nobody there. It kind of slow your juice down a little bit.
Thank you.
So, did you ever come close to losing to a cupcake team, one that Clemson would have paid to come play y'all?
As I recall, my freshman year we played Troy, but I don't think Troy is a. They always got some good kids coming out of there, but Troy was a game that we really almost lost. We went into halftime, got booed by the fans, ended up coming back to win that game, but that was definitely a hard fight that I'm sure that wouldn't have went well with the Clemson Nation if we lost that.
No doubt. I mean, Georgia doesn't pay Vanderbilt to play them, but we almost lost to Vanderbilt in 2011. There was a blocked punt late in the game. Guess who made the tackle to save the tackle?
Did you?
Of course I did.
Yeah, I'm just not very good at playing in Vanderbilt, I guess.
Come on now. I made the tackle, and we won the game. I will take full responsibility.
You know how we lost that game to Vandy? That was a year with the targeting. You know, the player gets ejected, and then you get 15 yards. Well, this was before, you know, they go review it, and if it said, okay, it wasn't targeting, the player's back in the game, but they didn't give them the 15 yards back.
Gotcha.
So they got a first down, which should have been a first down. They scored a touchdown to tie it or take the lead. So really – they shouldn't have scored. because it wasn't a penalty, but the rules were kind of screwed up at that point.
And
that
lost
the game. So once again, referees screwing us up,
man. Thank you. I'm getting you on the bandwagon. You're coming over quickly. Georgia Southern was paid by Clemson to play the Tigers last week. And if you watched the game, you saw Georgia Southern's defensive tackle, C.J. Wright, who weighs 290 pounds. Yeah. He was toting the rock out there as a running back. Yeah. Could you even imagine tackling a guy like that? I mean, I know you're in the trenches.
Yeah, I mean, I cut the game on. I'm always going to watch my Tigers on. And I'm like, man, they handing this kid out the bike, getting like eight yards a carry. Like, but and then as the commentators was pumping him up, my old boy, and now it's Pinkley going there, bam, bam, rip it out. And I don't know if he got any more carries after that. So.
No, I think so, they probably put him on the
bench.
So,
I mean, they definitely, we get a guy who's not used to carrying the ball all the time, it's kind of easy to get it out. But, I mean, he was putting on, he clearly showed him something at practice to give him faith enough to carry the ball. I'm sure that's any kind of defensive lineman dream, though.
No doubt.
I never got to live that dream.
So. Did you ever have to tackle somebody on an interception return or anything like that?
Oh, many of times. It's
did
not
you
fun.
Actually tackle him or no. They juke you out?
My goal,
just getting away.
My goal is to kind of just slow him down.
You just got to get in the way.
Get in the way, make him zigzag, absolutely. And pray someone else will catch him. That's the last thing I want to do.
Who's the toughest guy you have to tackle now in the NFL?
Let me see.
Got some big guys in there.
Yeah, we do got some big guys, but I'll tell you, one of the tougher tackles is not a big guy, Alvin Kamara.
Oh, yeah.
He's a very strong, elusive guy. He's hard to get down. I mean, there's a really, like you said, man, everybody in Cam is real hard. I missed like two, three sacks this past game. You know, got the pressure, but you know, you want the sack, you know. Yeah. But so Cam is definitely a hard guy to get down. There's a lot of them. So you gotta come correct. Gotta always run your feet. And but you know, got some of them that'll fold. Usually the receivers, they kind of catch a little jailbreak screen coming inside. I pull out. They just don't want none of that work.
If you look into some YouTube clips, you'll find me trying to tackle some guys. Maybe in the SEC I wasn't that good, but I mean I want a medal for this. I tackled Devin Hester in 2014.
Nice.
Had a nice punt in the Georgia Dome.
Former teammate.
Was about to house it. Eric Weems was like mauling me. I mean, in my face mask. So ref throws the flag. Well, I dump Hester.
Oh, you dumped him.
Check the tape. I got fined.
You got fined.
Weems got a 15-yarder. Keith Armstrong runs out of the field. He got a 15-yarder. They got the ball at the 31-yard line.
Oh, I need
guess
that clip.
Guess who loves some Drew in the locker room after that game? Everybody. I tackled Hester. Thank you very much. I believe that's probably one of my best plays in the NFL. And now we're going to go to our favorite segment, Believe It. This is Believe It, where we state what we believe to be true in college football. Believe It is sponsored by Geico. You won't believe how easy it is to save money with Geico. Geico makes it easy to switch and save hundreds on car insurance. Believe It. All right, Aaron, what do I believe in college football right now? You better believe it when I say that Alabama could be one of the best teams ever. I mean, look at what they're doing just through three games. Ole Miss scored the first possession. I think it was a 75-yard touchdown
first
pass
play,
last
baby.
Week. First play, 7-0 Ole Miss. Final score, 62-7, Alabama. Tua Tagovailoa hasn't even attempted a pass in the fourth quarter yet. These dudes are the real deal. Believe it, Alabama is one of the best college football teams in history.
I believe it that parents need to get off social media. We're talking about UCLA. Enough's enough. I mean, you are not the head coach. You're not the president. You're not the AD. Get off social media. This isn't about you. It's about your son. It's about the coaching. It's about the team. And these parents, and I think it's everyone now, they feel like they have a voice and their opinion means something.
Yeah.
Like your opinion
matters.
Does not matter.
No.
Chip Kelly doesn't care what you say about his offense.
Yeah, without a doubt.
He's getting
paid
too much to be the coach at UCLA. You're only hurting your son. Get off social media. Get off Twitter. Just delete it.
Absolutely.
Apologize and move on.
Grady, what do you believe in college football right now?
College football right now. I believe there are going to be some more big upsets coming up.
All right.
I think it's going to be some real head scratchers, some things we're not used to seeing, especially in the ACC. I also believe that Clemson got a two-headed monster at quarterback that's going to continue to have success throughout the year.
Yeah, no doubt. I think that's a pretty good one that everybody can get behind. Speaking about those two-headed monsters at quarterback, and I mentioned how good Tua Tagovailoa is playing at Alabama right now, Is it too early to talk Heisman? I mean, three games are in the books. You got guys like Tua at Alabama, Dwayne Haskins at Ohio State, who's just absolutely putting up phenomenal numbers. Go to the other side of the ball. Ed Oliver, who's an absolute freak, probably going to be a top five pick in the NFL draft next year at Houston as a defensive tackle. And Nick Bosa, I mean, he's a defensive end at Ohio State, just wreaking havoc. I'm going to ask you one question here, Grady. Any chance a defensive lineman could win the Heisman?
I think it's about time.
Really?
I think it's about time. They got two guys, like you just said, Oliver and Bosa, that can get it done. I mean, I love to watch Ed Oliver play. Me, as being a professional defensive tackle, I enjoy watching his clips. I mean, he just played relentless, sideline to sideline. He in the backfield. He even chasing guys down from the back and from like a zero nose position.
Yeah.
Like he got a lot of trash going on as a ball snap, and he getting through there. So, I mean, I got much respect for his game, man. And I think it's about time. I think it's, if he consistently do what he do, make some more big plays, maybe score a touchdown or two, I think he'd have won.
Let's not forget the Heisman Trophy goes to the most outstanding football player in America, not to the quarterback with the best stats.
The Heisman is really the number one quarterback in the game.
That's what it is.
If you want to ask me who mine
that's
are.
What it is. That's why I say it's time. It's time to change.
It's all about the pretty boys who touch the football every single play. And I'm not talking about the center.
I got to show the big ugly some love, man.
Tua, obviously. Haskins is up there.
He's a baller.
Haskins, Tua, Kyler Murray at Oklahoma. I mean, especially with their running back out, what he's doing, throwing it, running, and being a dual threat quarterback that just jumps you up in everyone's chart. The excitement, the highlights. And let's not forget about Will Greer. I know he had a postponed game. So I think everyone kind of forgot about him a little bit, but Will Greer is the real deal now. I mean, he is unbelievable, and he's going to be throwing four or five touchdowns a game. He's going to be up there. Right now, if I had to pick, I got to go with Dwayne Haskins. Yeah. I mean, what he's done, and plus a big win against TCU on the road, he just looks incredible. I mean, big, strong arm, gets the ball out accurately. He's everything you want in a quarterback, and he's going to put the numbers up all year long too. But it's going to be one of those quarterbacks. I really don't see anyone else taking it.
My objective pick through 3 weeks in college football for the Heisman Trophy winner is Rodrigo Blankenship, the kicker from Georgia. He's 100% on field goals, 100% on extra points, and 100% on touchbacks. If he keeps that up, send him to New York, please. Because you talk about it needing to be time for a special teamer to get in there, too.
Goggles on the stage.
Speaking of defensive linemen, though, Clemson's defensive line, they've got four potential first-round NFL draft picks right now. They're playing Georgia Tech just down the street this weekend. Tech runs that option offense, so it might be a long day for the Yellow Jackets. How does Clemson produce such great defensive line talent over and over and over again?
I think it's a combination of a couple things. I think what you're looking for in a defensive lineman when you're recruiting them and the development that they have when they get to the program. And also, the standard that they have to live up to with the guys who've come out of there. So, I mean, the guys that they got now, they're the best of the country at their respective positions. You said I feel like they all had the chance to become first rounders. And, I just enjoy watching them. Me being from that program and seeing the success that they have, me being able to communicate with these guys, talk to them, and just seeing them work day in and day out. I mean, usually you get guys with a lot of hype, and they might go to their head a little bit, they might relax a little bit, but these guys are grinders, man. So, I enjoy watching, Cleveland make the big plays, Christian, Dexter. I mean, Austin is having an amazing year. I don't see him slowing down.
No.
Especially, and then you saw Georgia Tech this year. We play Georgia Tech every year since now, so they know how to play it. You go watch them play it, they dominant in it. So, I mean, ain't no hiding from it. So, they coming, man.
Could you imagine ever having that much legitimate NFL talent just in one unit in the football field? I mean, I know you had Gurley. You had AJ for a few years. It's just crazy what's going on right
now. It changes the game. I mean, the two most important positions are, can you get after a quarterback and can you protect the quarterback?
Yeah, no
because,
question.
I mean, that's it's all about the QB.
Yeah, without a doubt.
So find ways to get after him and then find ways to protect him. And if you have four guys like that, it's not
really
only dominant.
Like pick your poison, man.
Well, then you free up the linebackers.
Without a doubt. And they got some good
linebackers,
too.
If you got a double team and do all this stuff, then linebackers are flying everywhere. It's a nightmare, man. You look at that D-line, it is an absolute nightmare. And then it only helps the DBs, too, because if a quarterback has 2 seconds to throw the football instead of three or four, then it's just slants, it's quick hitches, it's you can't really push the ball down the field. it makes everyone's job easier.
It makes everyone's job easier, including the kind of puppet master of that defensive nightmares, and that's Brett Venables. I would call him kind of the unsung hero
without a doubt, for Clemson's
success. I mean, speak about the kind of coach he is and how he is able to develop talent like yourself, but now all the 4 and 5 stars they're getting.
Oh, man. Coach V, man. Coach V a trip. He's very, very intense. He's very, very smart. You know, sometimes you'll see on college football, the defensive coordinators up in the box, the call sheets. We're going to call this versus personnel. We're going to call this versus personnel. I'm telling you, me working or playing for Coach V for 3 years, he has it all in his head. Yeah. So he know the calls he playing. They come out 12 personnel. This formation, I'm calling these two plays. I'm calling so. The downside of that a little bit, we used to be kind of waiting for the call a little bit too late. So, but he got a lot better at that. But I mean, he's like a machine, man. He sees the personnel formation. We got the call. It got to the point where I would know why he called certain calls. I feel like that's kind of what separate how y'all guys talk about details.
Yeah, for sure.
You gotta understand, be in tune with your coordinator. Why did you call this? What are you expecting to come? So for him, he used to call certain plays. So I used to be like, all right, man, I know. I feel I got 2-3 plays, but I'm probably about to get because he called this. So, I mean, he's like you said, I feel like he's an unsung hero. I feel like he's a guy who had, you know, opportunities, you know, to do other things, but I feel like he loves it so much. And he enjoys coaching defense. He enjoys being in the role that he's in, and he wanted to be the best at it. And he got the guys to do it. And so, I mean, I'm glad that he came into, you know, my life as my coordinator during that time, because you know it was a big year for me from my freshman year to sophomore year, and being able to lead the defense from that point on. So I shout out to him.
Yeah, man, no doubt. He's not probably gonna have that much fun this week as week 4 begins and Clemson travels to Atlanta to take on Georgia Tech. Now, Tech is not good this year. We all know that. They're 1-2, I believe, but never fun to kind of approach that chop block, cut block offense, for sure. And I know you'll probably be
and they're going to bring their best. They always going to bring their best. Every time somebody playing a big school, especially like Tech versus Clemson, they're going to bring their best, no matter the record. And Coach Sweeney always makes sure that they know every week you're going to get somebody the best shot. So they're going to probably get plays they never seen before, a couple trick plays. And so they just got to be ready.
Yeah, week 4 is going to be great, Aaron. We got a couple top 25 matchups. Yep. Obviously, as I just mentioned, Clemson heading to Atlanta to take on Georgia Tech. Is the best game going to be Alabama hosting Texas A&M? Because I'll tell you right now, what's going to happen is that Alabama's going to win by 40-plus points. Tua Tagovailoa probably won't even play in the fourth quarter. These guys are on a different level. What's the game you're most looking forward to week 4?
I'm actually looking forward to Stanford-Oregon. Okay. Listen, I'm excited for that A&M-Alabama game. Can A&M – it's easy to get up for one game. I mean, you're playing Clemson. Yeah. It's at home. You're juiced. You got the crowd behind you. I had a feeling that could have been close. Now you're going at Alabama. Alabama just waxed Ole Miss.
It's
on the road. You don't have that big 101,000 fans behind you getting the defense going. I don't see that's going to be much of a competition. I think Alabama, no one can stop by. They're too good. So I think the Oregon-Stanford game is going to be a little bit more competitive. Bryce Love off last week. They gave him time to heal up, feel better. Then Justin Herbert, quarterback for Oregon.
Yeah.
I'm high on this kid. I mean, 6'6", big arm, strong, has 12 touchdowns this year, and it's at Oregon, one of the toughest environments to play. I like Oregon. I think Oregon has a shot in this game, but I think that's going to be the most competitive game we'll see this weekend.
All right, well, let's get into our picks. Week 4 starting this weekend. We're finally getting into the meat of the college football season. We're going to find out who the contenders are and certainly who the pretenders are. Let's start with that game at 3:30 on CBS. Number 22, Texas A&M, traveling to Tuscaloosa to take on number 1, Alabama. Alabama, a heavy favorite. I mean, Grady, these guys cannot be stopped. What's going to happen at 3:30 on Saturday?
I feel like Alabama's going to win.
Yeah.
But I feel like Texas A&M going to put up a fight.
Really?
To be honest.
A four-quarter fight.
I feel like they took my Tigers all the way to the end. I think that they got some legit talent over there. But man, y'all said it, man. Alabama on another level, man. And I'll be a fool to deny that. And I'm a big Tua fan. I love the way the kid play. And I was watching a little bit of the game coming on the elevator at the team hotel. They like scored like twice while I'm on the elevator, man. So
we had Ben Bolwer on a teammate of yours at Clemson, and he likened Tua to Deshaun Watson. And I had never really thought of that comparison before. I mean, those guys can make plays very well with their arm and get outside the pocket and extend it with their feet too. So, I mean, just what a dynamic guy to try to defend.
I think the bigger stat, I wonder if this is actually a line for the weekend, does Tua throw a pass in the fourth quarter?
Yeah.
That's what I wanted. I mean, could someone force him to actually play a full game?
No, not A&M.
He's never,
that's a short answer.
He's never played a full game. Last year, backup role. National championship game, only played a half. And then this season, three games, he's only
That's true.
I mean, he's never played an entire football game in college. It's crazy.
His third down statistics right now, this is off the top of my head, 12 of 12 passing, 296 yards and 6 touchdowns on third down.
He is a big crush on Tua.
I mean, the guy is the good
memorizer. Oh, he definitely lighting up over there.
He is the real deal. This game will not be close. Nestler and Danielson will be looking for something to talk about around 6 p.m. on CBS. Alabama rolls big. Aaron, your favorite game of the week, number 7, Stanford, going to Eugene. They're taking on number 20, Oregon. Stanford, a road favorite here. Bryce Love, KJ Costello, I mean, they've proven what they can do. I don't know if Oregon's there yet, though. I think Stanford wins this game and wins it in pretty dominating fashion.
I don't know about dominating. Stanford is not built to dominate. I mean, they're built to play good defense. They're built to run the football.
Yeah.
I like their quarterback. It's just I don't think they can dominate a football game. And then, like I said, flip the script with Herbert. I think he's a very talented quarterback. He can keep them in the game, especially being in Eugene, one of the toughest places to play. I think it's going to be closer than most people anticipate. And I think I have Oregon squeaking this one out.
Any thoughts on this game, Grady?
I'm thinking Stanford. I like the running back. I feel like he knows it's at stake for him and his future as far as what he want to continue to progress in his career. I feel like he's going to have a big day on the ground.
No doubt. All right, let's go to your favorite team, the Clemson Tigers. They're going to go over to Grant Field, Bobby Dodd Stadium, taking on Georgia Tech, the Yellow Jackets. Clemson is a heavy favorite, as you could imagine. And I would think Trevor Lawrence gets a lot of burn in this game because Georgia Tech is having some serious troubles, not only on the offensive side of the ball getting touchdowns, they can't stop anybody right now. Well, Clemson's going to put up a ton of points.
Listen, Kelly Bryant, little chest, I think, bruise last week in the game.
Yeah.
Put him on the bench. Yeah. Let him heal. let's put Mr. Flo in there for a full game and see what the future looks like for four quarters. I'm a big fan of Kelly Bryant. I think Kelly Bryant's the guy going forward, but he is a little banged up. I mean, even if it's minor, let's see what Lawrence can do for an entire four quarters. I don't think you're worrying about this game. Obviously, like you said, everyone's going to give Clemson their best.
Yep.
That triple option is going to be a pain in the butt, but you should handily win this football game. Let's see what he can do.
Interesting approach. Would you play Kelly Bryant? I know he's got the little bruised sternum, but just put Trevor Lawrence in
there. I feel like if he's ready, if he's healthy, I feel like they're going to play him. But, I'll tell you this, Trevor Lawrence, man, he the real deal. You know, some guys, the ball just come off their hand different, you know. And, I got to see him in person going up to a spring game. And, like I said, I feel like he just got it. But Kelly Bryant, to me, is a winner. So I think it's going to be good to see how they go as it go on. But, I mean, it's going to be a rough day for that Georgia Tech offense. I can say that without a doubt.
Yeah.
And like you said, people putting on points. And we got good receivers, good running backs. I feel like ETN, one of my favorite players on Clemson team, the running back, number 9, I feel like he's going to have a big day. I really enjoy watching him play.
They certainly have a two-headed monster at the quarterback position. You said I love Tua Tagovailoa. We met Trevor Lawrence this spring. Okay, this guy. Looking at that, oh, his hair is so nice. Grady, I had him go get.
What conditioner does he use? He is a secret he wouldn't tell me.
I had him go get Selfish. Trevor for an interview, and people thought Aaron was a media guy because Trevor Lawrence is legitimately 6'6".
Oh, man, I was walking behind
Aaron's
him.
Walking around like, hey, come follow me. I was like, this is crazy. He's legit. Clemson will win that game big time. I think a competitive game that can happen, this is our last one for week 4. It may not be the best brand of football, but Florida is traveling to Rocky Top. They're taking on Tennessee. Two hallmark brands
in
the SEC.
Yeah, I think that's going to be a good one.
Can't figure out what exactly is going on. Both have first-year head coaches, Jeremy Pruitt for the Vols, your boy Dan Mullen for the Gators. Florida, I don't even know how they got this. Florida is a 4.5-point favorite. I've gotten so many text messages this week, who do you like? I simply say, I have no idea. What's going to happen?
I don't know either. I mean, this is – unfortunately, this is not going to be – great SEC football, in my opinion. And people think Tennessee, you think Florida, you're like, this
great
is,
game. Great
this is,
early
these
SEC
brands
game.
Are incredible. Yeah. I mean, Tennessee, Florida, great brand. This should be an incredible football game. I think this could be ugly. I think this could be just like watching some
9-6, 12-9.
Just sloppy tackling, sloppy offensively, turnovers. But Garantano, Tennessee quarterback, he's played well this year. I mean, even going back to the first game versus West Virginia, I think he's 19-25 for a touchdown, and he's played consistent this year. flip it, Felipe Franks, good first game in the past two, has just looked like he's lost like he did last season. This could be ugly, but Tennessee must win this football game.
They have to.
You look at their next four games, it's at Georgia, at Alabama, South Carolina.
And they play A&M maybe?
And then they play A&M or something like that. I mean, they got four games where they're probably going to lose. This is a must-win for Tennessee if they even want to think about getting to a bowl.
These two teams don't like each other, and they probably both know at the end of the day they're not very good football teams. What's the approach? You just got to go out there and get first downs and not turn the ball over?
Yeah, I feel like you, man. I don't know how it's going to come out. I don't know how it's going to come out, but I feel like you said, I feel like they're going to fight each other to the end. They neither team is really doing great, you know, right now. So, I feel like it'll be a game that I'll watch, like, in the third, fourth quarter. To see if it's worth finishing watching.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if Tennessee's heads and Florida's tails, Tennessee heads at home. Tennessee
so I
wins
think
that
be a
game.
Close game.
Yeah,
so.
Absolutely. All right, this has been a fantastic and fun episode. Grady, thanks so much for joining us right here at the College Football Hall of Fame in Atlanta, Georgia. This place is awesome. Come check it out if you're in town. This is the epicenter of college football. You will not want to miss it. Thanks for joining. We'll see you next week.